Indian Rebellion of 1857. Civilian disquiet. Civilian rebellion was more multifarious. The rebels consisted of three groups: the feudal nobility, rural landlords called taluktars, and the peasants. The nobility, many of whom had lost titles and domains under the doctrine of lapse, which refused to recognize the adopted children of princes as legal heirs, felt that the company had interfered with a traditional system of inheritance. Rebel leaders such as Nana Sahib and the Rani of Jhansi belonged to this group. The latter, for example, was prepared to accept East India Company supremacy if her adopted son was recognized as her late husband's heir. In other areas of central India, such as Indore and Sogha, where such loss of privilege had not occurred, the princes remained loyal to the company, even in areas where the sepoys had rebelled. The second group, the taluktars, had lost half their landed estates to peasant farmers as a result of the land reforms that came in the wake of annexation of Oudh. As the rebellion gained ground, the taluktars quickly reoccupied the lands they had lost, and paradoxically, in part because of ties of kinship and feudal loyalty, did not experience significant opposition from the peasant farmers, many of whom joined the rebellion, to the great dismay of the British. It has also been suggested that heavy land revenue assessment in some areas by the British resulted in many landowning families either losing their land or going into great debt to money lenders, and providing ultimately a reason to rebel. Money lenders, in addition to the company, were particular objects of the rebels' animosity. The civilian rebellion was also highly uneven in its geographic distribution, even in areas of north-central India that were no longer under British control. For example, the relatively prosperous Muzaffarnagar district, a beneficiary of a company irrigation scheme, and next door to Meerut, where the upheaval began, stayed relatively calm throughout. Utilitarian and evangelical-inspired social reform, including the abolition of sati and the legalization of widow remarriage, were considered by many, especially the British themselves, to have caused suspicion that Indian religious traditions were being interfered with the ultimate aim of conversion. Recent historians, including Chris Bailey, have preferred to frame this as a clash of knowledges, with proclamations from religious authorities before the revolt and testimony after it, including on such issues as the insults to women, the rise of low persons under British tutelage, the pollution caused by Western medicine, and the persecuting and ignoring of traditional astrological authorities. British-run schools were also a problem. According to recorded testimonies, anger had spread because of stories that mathematics was replacing religious instruction. Stories were chosen that would bring contempt upon Indian religions, and because girl children were exposed to moral danger by education. The justice system was considered to be inherently unfair to the Indians. The official Blue Books, East India 1855-1857, laid before the House of Commons during the sessions of 1856 and 1857, revealed that company officers were allowed an extended series of appeals if convicted or accused of brutality or crimes against Indians. The economic policies of the East India Company were also resented by many Indians. The Bengal Army. Each of the three presidencies into which the East India Company divided India for administrative purposes maintained their own armies. Of these, the army of the Bengal Presidency was the largest. Unlike the other two, it recruited heavily from among high-caste Hindus and comparatively wealthy Muslims. The Muslims formed a larger percentage of the 18 irregular cavalry units within the Bengal army, whilst Hindus were mainly to be found in the 84 regular infantry and cavalry regiments. The sepoys were therefore affected to a large degree by the concerns of the landholding and traditional members of Indian society. In the early years of company rule, it tolerated and even encouraged the caste privileges and customs within the Bengal army, which recruited its regular soldiers almost exclusively amongst the landowning Brahmins and Rajputs of the Bihar and Avadh regions. These soldiers were known as Purbiyas. By the time these customs and privileges came to be threatened by modernizing regimes in Calcutta from the 1840s onwards, the sepoys had become accustomed to very high ritual status and were extremely sensitive to suggestions that their caste might be polluted. The sepoys also gradually became dissatisfied with various other aspects of army life. Their pay was relatively lower, and after Awadh and the Punjab were annexed, the soldiers no longer received extra pay for service there, because they were no longer considered foreign missions. The junior British officers became increasingly estranged from their soldiers, in many cases treating them as their racial inferiors. In 1856, a new enlistment act was introduced by the company, which in theory made every unit in the Bengal army liable to service overseas. Although it was intended to apply only to new recruits, the serving sepoys feared that the act might be applied retroactively to them as well. A high-caste Hindu who travelled in the cramped conditions of a wooden troop ship could not cook his own food on his own fire, and accordingly risked losing caste through ritual pollution. onset of the rebellion. Several months of increasing tensions coupled with various incidents preceded the actual rebellion. On the 26th of February 1857, the 19th Bengal Native Infantry Regiment became concerned that new cartridges they had been issued were wrapped in paper greased with cow and pig fat, which had to be opened by mouth, thus affecting their religious sensibilities. Their colonel confronted them supported by artillery and cavalry on the parade ground, but after some negotiation withdrew the artillery and cancelled the next morning's parade. Mangal Pandey. On the 29th of March 1857 at the Barrackpore Parade Ground, near Calcutta, 29-year-old Mangal Pandey of the 34th BNI, angered by the recent actions of the East India Company, declared that he would rebel against his commanders. Informed about Pandey's behavior, Sergeant Major James Hewson went to investigate, only to have Pandey shoot at him. Hewson raised the alarm. When his adjutant Lieutenant Henry Bohr came out to investigate the unrest, Pandey opened fire but hit Bohr's horse instead. General John Hersey came out to the parade ground to investigate and claimed later that Mangal Pandey was in some kind of religious frenzy. He ordered the Indian commander of the quarter guard Jemadar Ishwari Prasad to arrest Mangal Pandey, but the Jemadar refused. The quarter guard and other sepoys present, with the single exception of a soldier called Sheikh Paltu, drew back from restraining or arresting Mangal Pandey. Sheikh Paltu restrained Pandey from continuing his attack. After failing to incite his comrades into an open and active rebellion, Mangal Pandey tried to take his own life by placing his musket to his chest and pulling the trigger with his toe. He managed only to wound himself. He was court-martialed on the 6th of April and hanged 2 days later. The Jemadar Ishwari Prasad was sentenced to death and hanged on the 22nd of April. The regiment was disbanded and stripped of its uniforms because it was felt that it harbored ill feelings towards its superiors, particularly after this incident. Sheikh Paltu was promoted to the rank of Havaldar in the Bengal Army, but was murdered shortly before the 34th BNI dispersed. Sepoys in other regiments thought these punishments were harsh. The demonstration of disgrace during the formal disbanding helped foment the rebellion in view of some historians. Disgruntled ex-sepoys returned home to Awadh with a desire for revenge. Unrest during April 1857. During April, there was unrest and fires at Agra, Allahabad and Ambala. At Ambala in particular, which was a large military cantonment where several units had been collected for their annual musketry practice, it was clear to General Anson, Commander-in-Chief of the Bengal Army, that some sort of rebellion over the cartridges was imminent. Despite the objections of the civilian Governor-General's staff, he agreed to postpone the musketry practice and allow a new drill by which the soldiers tore the cartridges with their fingers rather than their teeth. However, he issued no general orders making this standard practice throughout the Bengal Army and, rather than remain at Ambala to defuse or overawe potential trouble, he then proceeded to Simla, the cool hill station, where many high officials spent the summer. Although there was no open revolt at Ambala, there was widespread arson during late April. Barrack buildings and British officers' bungalows were set on fire. Meerut. At Meerut, a large military cantonment, 2,357 Indian sepoys and 2,038 British soldiers were stationed along with 12 British manned guns. The station held one of the largest concentrations of British troops in India and this was later to be cited as evidence that the original rising was a spontaneous outbreak rather than a pre-planned plot. Although the state of unrest within the Bengal Army was well known, on the 24th of April Lieutenant Colonel George Carmichael Smith, the unsympathetic commanding officer of the 3rd Bengal Light Cavalry, ordered 90 of his men to parade and perform firing drills. All except 5 of the men on parade refused to accept their cartridges. On the 9th of May, the remaining 85 men were court-martialed and most were sentenced to 10 years imprisonment with hard labor. 11 comparatively young soldiers were given 5 years imprisonment. The entire garrison was paraded and watched as the condemned men were stripped of their uniforms and placed in shackles. As they were marched off to jail, the condemned soldiers berated their comrades for failing to support them. The next day was Sunday. Some Indian soldiers warned off-duty junior British officers that plans were afoot to release the imprisoned soldiers by force, but the senior officers to whom this was reported took no action. There was also unrest in the city of Meerut itself, with angry protests in the bazaar and some buildings being set on fire. In the evening, most British officers were preparing to attend church, while many of the British soldiers were off duty and had gone into canteens or into the bazaar in Meerut. The Indian troops, led by the 3rd Cavalry, broke into revolt. British junior officers who attempted to quell the first outbreaks were killed by the rebels. British officers and civilians' quarters were attacked, and 4 civilian men, 8 women and 8 children were killed. crowds in the bazaar attacked off-duty soldiers there. About 50 Indian civilians, some of them officers' servants who tried to defend or conceal their employers, were killed by the sepoys. While the action of the sepoys in freeing their 85 imprisoned comrades appears to have been spontaneous, some civilian rioting in the city was reportedly encouraged by Kotwal Dhan Singh Gurjar. Some sepoys escorted trusted British officers and women and children to safety before joining the revolt. Some officers and their families escaped to Rampur, where they found refuge with the Nawab. The British historian Philip Mason notes that it was inevitable that most of the sepoys and sowas from Meerut should have made for Delhi on the night of the 10th of May. It was a strong walled city located only 40 miles away, it was the ancient capital and present seat of the nominal Mughal emperor, and finally there were no British troops in garrison there in contrast to Meerut. No effort was made to pursue them.